My name is Alec Fry. I'm currently a production director at Obsidian Entertainment. I've been working at Obsidian for about 4 years. I started out at the company on Tyranny and have been a producer on the Pillars of Eternity property for over 3 years now. I had the pleasure of releasing Pillars of Eternity on PlayStation and Xbox, and I'm now working hard on finishing up the Switch version of Pillars so that it'll release on August 8th. I think my favorite part about Pillars is the story and history behind its development. The project was started by a bunch of devs who had some really strong role-playing chops. Many of them had worked at Black Isle on some of the original RPG classics, such as Baldur's Gate, Nicewind Dale, but couldn't find outside funding for what the industry believed was kind of an obsolete genre. Obsidian believed in the project and set a crowdfunding goal of $1 million, well, over $1 million. At the time, this was a really bold undertaking, as crowdfunding was pretty new and the industry hadn't seen many successful projects of that scope. The development team sat in awe as over 77,000 fans backed the project. Pillars of Eternity went on to remind the world how amazing classic role-playing games can be. Obsidian had set out to create an epic story that reacted to your choices in a fantastic world with deep combat and massive customization. Not only were we successful in our goal, but we also ended up contributing to the resurrection of an entire genre. So, over the last little bit, you've been seeing our initial player customization screen. For those of you who are used to playing RPGs, this might be a familiar scene. In Pillars, the player can choose between 6 different races and 11 different classes. Well, we've taken heavy inspiration from traditional fantasy RPGs. The world that Pillars of Eternity is set in, Eora, is a totally original universe. So while we have the elves and dwarves or players looking for something more familiar, we also have towering Aumaua, small but savage Orlans, and our divinity-affected godlikes for players looking for something a little off the beaten path. Each race comes with its own set of baggage and perks. For instance, godlikes can range from being considered blessed by the gods and a beacon of hope for a society, or in some cultures are considered to be the cause of curses when they're born. In the same vein, we have 11 playable classes, which can range anywhere from the traditional fighter, priest, rogue, and wizard to the Eoran version of bards called chanters. My personal favorite class is the Cypher, actually, who can alter the minds of their foes to shift the battlefield to their advantage. Like many of the decisions the player makes during character creation, the class you choose will affect how the world reacts to you. Cyphers, while cool and unique to Eora, are relatively new to the world and are often regarded with suspicion and fear. If you're new to this kind of system, fighters and barbarians can be a little easier to pick up, whereas if you'd like to play a spell-slinging wizard or a priest, be prepared to have a lot of abilities to manage. Since Pillars of Eternity got all of its AI improvements, you can play on some of the easier difficulties and only worry about managing your Watcher, if you want. Or, if you want to take on our Path of the Damned difficulty, you'll be required to pause a lot and know what every ability does to make it through alive. For those who haven't gotten a chance to experience the world of Eora, Pillars of Eternity is a real-time with pause role-playing game. This is similar to how the combat works in older Baldur's Gate, or more recently, the Dragon Age series if you're familiar with those. At any time, you can pause the game, issue commands to your party, and then unpause the game and watch those commands play out. At the beginning of the game, which you see here, you create a character known as the Watcher, who has the power to perceive and interact with the souls of others. Having this gift sets you on a path to learn about a secret organization and uncover the history of Eora. Along the way, the Watcher meets many allies with their own stories to dive into. From Adair, a human war veteran and farmer whose luck has pretty much run out, to Aloth, an elf wizard who lives with an internal conflict that he must try to deal with, or grow to accept. There are 11 companions to recruit in Pillars of Eternity. Each companion is a different class and has their own quest to dive deeper into their lore. Alternatively, if you don't want to add the companions to your party and want to make an entire party of druids that can turn into bears, that's also available by hiring custom party members from the inn. Your journey in Eora explores themes about how a society will turn to superstition or science when coping with a world-shattering catastrophe. The believability of how they interpret and approach the situation is a testament to the brilliant narrative team's understanding of historical events. The game constantly asks you, what would you do in this situation? And I think the real heart of an Obsidian game is both making sure that those moments are difficult choices, and then confirming or surprising the player with the outcomes of those choices. Pillars of Eternity leans very heavily on player choice. As the Watcher, you're more than just a beacon of light in a dark world. You're a flawed, nuanced character with a personal history that you get to define. You can solve your problems with a wide variety of dialogue options, using lies and persuasion to get your way. You can also keep it simple, letting swords and fireballs do the talking. We track the disposition your character grows over time, and NPCs out in the world will know you by your deeds and your temperament. If you can think of an unconventional way to solve a particular quest, try it out. Pick your friend's pocket, talk your way out of a fight, break up alliances, make new ones. The game's going to remember. Many of our fans have grown attached to the Watcher as they crafted over time, even bringing them out of Eora and into their tabletop games. Your character is more than their sword and shield, more than numbers on a character sheet. They are the culmination of choices made and ones yet to come. When we add to the Pillars universe, we make sure that we're catering to many different approaches and personalities. There is no right way to play. We work extra hard so that you can color outside the lines and make the experience yours. At the time of its campaign, Pillars of Eternity was the most successful Kickstarter ever, raising over $4 million. The game went on to win many awards over the years and still is played by fans every single day. Because of how dedicated our fans are, we want to make sure that Pillars of Eternity is available to as many players as possible, so putting it on the console just honestly seemed like the next step. To be completely honest, it wasn't always such a clear call. When I was approached to put Pillars on console, I'd be lying if I didn't say that I hesitated. The game was originally made with mouse and keyboard in mind. The development team drew from and improved upon ideas that were created for old CRPGs like Baldur's Gate, Icewind Dale, and Planescape Torment. These games are great, but were all made to be played on a desktop computer, so you can see where problems may have arisen. Naturally, we started out doing extensive research to see what UI and UX changes were available that made other PC games feel good on console. Since we could no longer depend on players having a keyboard and mouse, things like casting spells, moving characters, that all had to be rewritten from the ground up. Managing inventory, talking to PCs, and interacting with the world were all aspects of gameplay that completely had to change. Moving Pillars from PC to console forced us to think about how the game presents on a screen. Pillars is a very rich story. This means that delivery of dialogue and narration have to be smoothly integrated into the rest of the game. The average PC gamer sits a couple of feet away from their computer screen, whereas the average console gamer sits much farther from their TV. We had to make sure that the text was readable and clear at a distance. This is an even bigger challenge on the Nintendo Switch, where the player could swap between using the console in handheld mode or the TV dock. These were big technological challenges, but ones that we wanted to conquer if it meant expanding Pillars of Eternity to a much wider audience. Now, the dialogue window on the Switch takes up a much larger portion of the screen than it used to, making the game comfortable at a distance and cozy up close. We knew the Switch version of the game would require a number of optimization adjustments before we were satisfied with the experience, so we changed how lighting and shadows worked. The frame rate on the Switch is now higher than our initial projections. In the end, we are able to find an experience that we think both runs well on the Switch and still really captures the beauty and charm of Pillars of Eternity. We're very excited for everyone to get their hands on it. Being able to play through epic role-playing experiences while on the go is something that hasn't really existed this way until recently. Most large RPGs still exist on PC or more powerful home consoles. But with games like The Witcher and Skyrim making their way to the Switch, there's an entirely new way to play these games. To me, the thought of exploring a fantastic and dangerous realm while drowning out the baby crying three rows back on a flight, or slaying a dragon during an hour-long commute on the L train, was always the selling point of the Switch. The incredible portability of the Switch coupled with Pillars of Eternity is like having a choose-your-own-adventure novel that's packed with 100 hours of content. The first time I had Pillars running on a Switch at the studio, people lined up to try it out. Developers that had worked on the game and knew everything there was to know about Pillars wanted to play it just because it was on the Switch. And now that I've gotten an opportunity to try it out myself, I am upset that we ever waited this long. Just so everyone knows what exactly is coming to the Switch on August 8th, Pillars of Eternity Complete Edition contains all of the Pillars of Eternity content. It is the base game, plus both the White March expansions, Parts 1 and 2. There is no DLC being sold separately or anything like that. This is the whole package. So you can hop in on day one knowing that you're going to be able to get the entire Pillars of Eternity experience. Because Pillars of Eternity is all about player choice, we're overjoyed that we can give you another way to experience the game we cherish.